And it's, well, because periodically we get slammed by one of these things that kicks us back to a near Stone Age. This may be part of a universe, and that would also explain why there are not hundreds of thousands of Type 1 civilizations. And it may be that all the solar systems go through this, slamming it back repeatedly in the same kind of a process, and it's just a natural magnetism refresh sort of a thing, of an internal engine kind of a deal.
This breeding issue you raise brings to mind a story from several days ago of scientists apparently on the verge of making both sperm and eggs human quality from stem cells. In other words, we're not needed anymore.
Yeah, sure. Okay.
But they say...
And I'm sure that they'll succeed too, but it's like, why bother, guys?
Yeah.
You know, I know why there's a huge amount of work in fertility and infertility the past few years, by the way, and that is because sunspot cycles are related directly to fertility of all life on the planet, including humans. And the Mayans and the Egyptians also encoded that information in there.
I wonder if they had to deal with the same kind of mass planetary toxification. I mean, poisoning.
No. And that's,
which we are dealing with, and that's why the the estrogen attack on humankind and amphibians and everything else is creating all kinds of sexual chaos, as you know.
I actually would disagree. I think the sun is a primary cause, the primary cause, and the level of estrogen, certainly in plant-based estrogens in the social in the infrastructure, is something to be concerned with. But in general, I would think that it's the polar cycle of the sun, because the polar cycle of the sun is connected to both the testosterone and the estrogen flow within humans, and it's a 37-day cycle in spite of all evidence to the contrary in any other lunar cycles. And this 37-day cycle is at its weakest point that they've ever been able to measure since we've been able to measure these kind of things in the sun, and it's been degrading noticeably. The Germans did all kinds of measurements in it in the early 30s and were rather shocked about the level of degradation that they noticed in only 6 years, and then the war came along and stopped their efforts.
Is that why so many of the so-called advanced European cultures are not breeding much anymore? Is there any tie-in there?
Yeah, exactly. And it also affects all the species. That's why, for instance, we've had the four-year hiatus in naturally occurring spawn of oyster types off the west coast of the U.S. Mm-hmm. They're just simply not breeding. And a lot of these fertility cycles are directly related to the polar cycles.
Very interesting. Very interesting. All right, we're about 2 minutes away from break. Next hour, we're going to talk to Cliff High about the issue of a crustal shift and a massive recharging of the Earth's magnetosphere and what it may or may not do. Some of the scenarios are being put out there. Mr. Garrell feels he has... absolute certainty of where the safe places are, where the safe places aren't. How many days left, Cliff?
1,144, probably. If we're lucky.
If we're lucky.
Yeah, we've been lied to so repeatedly by the powers that be that do we trust their calendar or not? They were the ones that made the Mayan long count end on that day.
Yeah.
They could have been, you know, screwing around with us.
I'm not sure if it was Cotterell or not, but someone said that the Mayan calendar was actually 2 years too long in our view of it. We've been told it's not. It's actually 2010. It's not 2012. I don't know. Who knows?
Kalman thinks he knows, and I think his math is probably the better.
Who does?
John Kalman.
Oh, yeah.
And he thinks it's October or something, 2011.
Mm-hmm.
And there are a couple of astrological alignment issues that you can factor in there. But the Pope Gregory went to such great trouble and spent such a fortune on mathematicians in the 1500s to make the long count end at 11:11 a.m. on a day whose numbers all add up to 11, which is, you know, 12/21/2012.
I see.
And 11 is their key number for the Vatican as well as the Masons, etc. So they went to some trouble to do it. So I think that they at least have some indication that something's going to occur on that day.
That's their best bet.
Yeah. And they may know a lot more than we do, because I don't believe them when they say they burned all of those Mayan.
Oh, please.
Records.
They didn't burn anything.
Yeah.
No way. No, knowledge is power.
And books, yeah.
Sure. No way. I wonder if the Alexandria Library was completely desecrated or not. You never know. And if there is anything under the Giza Plateau by way of a record of the past, Believe me, it has been removed long ago.
No one's going to tell us, yeah.
That's right. All right, back another hour with Mr. Cliff High. Do look at the material at halfpasthuman.com or in the guests section at rents.com. Study up on that, and we'll come back and continue our conversation in just a few minutes. Back with you, and Cliff High, talking about 2012, what it may or may not mean. Cliff seems to think he's dialed in a pretty interesting scenario, and indeed he has. Again, you're invited to look at the special material in the guest box at rents.com, or just go to halfpasthuman.com, and you'll find it there. You know, Cliff, people talk about the 12th planet, Nibiru, and all that coming back. And in every culture at the very back end of their history is always the cataclysm. I think maybe the 12th planet is actually the sun.
You make a lot of idea of
a recurring giant or something.
Yeah, something that came in and disturbed the orbits at this level.
Yeah.
You should be able to notice that in the orbits years before it showed up, centuries. You would know about it.
Right. All right. Crustal shift. People right away are going to say, well, all right, Cliff, what about continental drift over the hundreds of millions of years, you know, 2 inches
every year? That's a supposition. That's never proven. That's just a supposition and can be easily, through just simple mental exercises, disputed, at least in some degree.
Sure.
Imagine a situation where you follow the academic line that England gradually drifted away from the continent. Well, then the first year that it separated, it moved, according to them, you know, 2.5 centimeters. I would maintain that it would fill with dirt, and it would be centuries and centuries and centuries before there was any noticeable parting. And on the converse side, the only way that such thing could happen and show the conditions that we have would be a very abrupt kind of an occurrence. In fact, if we go and we look in the current situation now in Africa over near Ethiopia, Somalia, in that region, we've got a new ocean forming there, as a new rift opened up over the course of 3 weeks and carved out, I think I want to say about 600 kilometers at that point, of a new super deep trench on the order of the Grand Canyon kind of a trench.
Mm-hmm.
And it happened in the course of weeks. Also, let's note that the fourth largest tectonic plate on the planet cracked in the matter of minutes, and that was the Indo-Australian plate that's now two plates, the Indo plate and the Australian plate, and it cracked in the same earthquake that caused the Banda Aceh tsunami. So such things happen rapidly, and in fact, the more you research this, reading Hapgood and others, the information keeps pointing to all of this stuff occurring on a level of rapidity that is just going to be staggering.
Some of these mountain ranges didn't take tens of millions of years to slowly upthrust, did they?
No, the idea is basically that as the inner core of the Earth shifts, it causes the cessation of angular momentum in the same direction of the orbit of the Earth, and the equatorial bulge of the Earth flattens out. This causes the Earth to become spherical, which not really, it's an oblate spheroid. It's fatter around the equator than it is around the poles. A key bit of information, too, in all these coatings, by the way.
So are most Americans.
yes. It's all gone horribly pear-shaped, as the Brits like to say.
Yeah.
In any event, though, so the inner core flips, and in the process it causes this situation where the equatorial bulge flattens out. Now, that bulge is 26 miles total, or about 13 miles on each side of the planet, composed of seabed and ocean and land.
Mm-hmm.
And so when it flattens out, we're able to spin, and we do so in a series of jerky kind of little motions. And it's that really that is both the saving grace and the terror that we have to go through. But because of the way that it does this, the relationship of the continents to each other is not guaranteed to be the same after the event as before.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, we won't necessarily sail around all at the same level. Some continents will come to a screeching halt, like, say, India or China, and then India rams into it really fast, and whoops, there's the Himalayas for you.
Got it.
And the supposition, by the way, is that it's feasible that the mountain range the size of the Himalayas occurred over the course of weeks. It's also the supposition that Lake Titicaca in the Andes Mountains was a seaport, and that it rose up to its current height of over 11,000 feet and did most of that rise in the first 72 hours based on the level of death in the local populace at the time
look
and
at the
level of destruction.
The major mountain ranges of the world, They generally are north-south. The Rockies, the Cascades, go down to
they
the Andes.
They actually have a 60-degree angle that's consistent with
that. And I was going to ask you, they're basically north-south, but they are all sort of leaning, if you look at them, one direction or the other, I guess depending on the hemisphere, but maybe not. And that would suggest
an angular kind of momentum, screeching effect. Yeah.
Yes, and a sudden cessation of it, and things just pile up.
Sort of like a slick floor, carpet with no sticky stuff that you can slide, and then you hit that carpet, and when you hit the wall, it just kind of all scrunches up. Yeah.
What do you have in the United States to point to that would suggest that kind of a carpet stack and thrusting a lot of vegetation maybe that's washed off the top into a compressed mass?
We have several different things within the continental U.S. that suggest just this. In fact, if you read all of the early literature of the explorers, including